Did you say Jesus is God? And the second question is, as everyone knows, Jesus is human. Same with us. If you say Jesus is God, so God is also human. Human, as you know, are not always perfect in everything. So why did we have to believe in a God like that?
Again, I would like to emphasize there are certain things that people may claim to know and certain things people may claim to believe. I do not come here this evening claiming that I can prove to you that Jesus is God. I believe that he was God because of my understanding of the scriptures, the ones that I read this evening, I believe that Jesus was claiming to be God. Second reason is I believe that his enemies were thinking that he was making that claim. Now, if my enemy believes me to be something, that certainly doesn't mean that I am that something. But it at least means that the enemies thought that that was the issue. And Jesus never, in my understanding, did anything to disagree with the judgment of his enemies. And then the third reason is, again, as Christians have thought about this over many, many centuries, they have concluded that. And someone might say, well, do you take it simply on the authority of others? I find that I'm always faced with taking things on the authority of other people or on my own authority. And if I hear many other people saying things and I hear only one voice in myself, then I want to think seriously about what the other people are saying. And Christians throughout the centuries have claimed that Jesus is God, and that through all the sources, the personal encounter, the scriptures, makes sense to me. The second question was, as everyone knows, Jesus is human. I agree. Jesus was human.
Yeah.
Now, and then he says, if you say Jesus is God, so God is also human. Human, as you know, are not always perfect in anything. So why do we have to believe in a God like that? Christians have tried to explain in the ways that Christians today still struggle with Jesus being the God-man, and they've tried to figure out how do you divide that up. And Christians have ended up that they don't... God became human, became flesh, in the sense that I might become another person, but I still am myself. In becoming another person, though, I am not that other person necessarily, but I'm experiencing what it means to be that other person, or experiencing what it's like to be that other person.
Thank you. Dr. Jamal Badawi, you said that the advent of Prophet Muhammad was prophesied in the Bible. Do you have any evidence to back up this statement?
The Bible is full of evidence, but our Christian brethren perhaps might have not been aware of that, and this is one virtue of those seminars. In the book of Genesis, we are told quite clearly that God promised to bless the nations of earth through the descendants of Abraham. We all know historically that all Israelite prophets came through his second son, Isaac. And we know historically that through his first son, Ishmael, Prophet Muhammad also was born. That itself is sufficient. However, there is confirmation of that also. In the book of Isaiah in chapter 11, when it speaks about someone great to come from the stem of Jesse, J-E-S-S-E, which has been sometimes mistakenly interpreted to mean the father of David. In fact, according to Encyclopedia Biblica under names, it says Jesse is an abbreviation of Ishmael, because Ishmael in Hebrew is Yishmael, abbreviated Yeshi, Jesse. Secondly, in the book of Deuteronomy, in chapter 18, verse 18, it is stated clearly, Moses addressing the Israelites in his presence, say that God will raise you from among your brethren a prophet like unto me. Now, how could that be applied, as some New Testament writers interpreted to apply to Jesus? Jesus is not of the brethren of the Israelites. He is himself an Israelite. Number two, he is believed to be the Son of God or God-man, and Moses was not God-man. How could we make comparison? The prophet like unto Moses, who lived like Moses, had a normal birth and death and had children and encountered his enemies and had both moral and physical victory, are definitely comparison between Muhammad and Moses, peace be upon them both. In the same book of Deuteronomy, in chapter 33, in the first two verses, we find that it speaks about Jesus, Moses, and Muhammad at the same time. It says, God came from Sinai, the Torah received by Moses, shined or rose up unto them from the hills of Seir. Seir is part of Palestine, that is where Jesus himself preached. And it says, he will shine forth from Mount Paran. According to the Bible, in the book of Genesis, chapter 21, verse 21, Paran is the place where Abraham took his son Ishmael and his mother Hagar, i.e. Mecca, as it's well known historically, and the monuments are still there, the Kaaba and the Well of Zamzam, since the days of Ishmael. The three are mentioned in the same, and notice the progression of revelation. God came, rose, shined forth, which means the final revelation to reveal the entire truth that all of these great prophets carried throughout history. You go to the book of Isaiah, chapter 42, and you find a clear profile of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in no unmistakable terms. While the chapter speaks about the elect of God, the select of God, the servant of God, and praises him, and speaks about the farthest isles waiting for his law, it says, let the villages that Kedar inhabits feel happy and joyful. And according to the Bible, in the book of Genesis, chapter 25, verse 13, Kedar is the name of the second son of Ishmael, i.e. it refers to the advent of Prophet Muhammad from Mecca. In the same book of Isaiah, in chapter 21, especially verses 13 through 17, we find a very prolific description of the migration of Prophet Muhammad from Mecca to Medina. It speaks about the people of Timan. And according to John McKenzie's dictionary of the Bible, Timan is an oasis north of what is now Medina. So you talk about the vicinity from which to which the Prophet migrated. Speak about the people of Timan bringing water to him that was thirsty, defending with their bread him that fled. Speak about those who fled to them because of persecution. Definitely a reference to the coming of Prophet Muhammad and his companions. But more importantly, it speaks also about Kedar in the same chapter, that the number of the mighty men of Kedar will be diminished. And that's exactly what happened, because 1 year after the migration of the Prophet, peace be upon him, the pagans from Kedar, from his own clan, came to destroy him, and they failed. If you move very quickly and leave so many other signs to the New Testament, in the Gospel according to John, chapter 1, verses 19 to 25, when John the Baptist came, the Jews sent their scholars to ask him, are you Elijah, the second coming of Elias? He said, no. They said, are you Christ? He said, no. Then they asked a third and distinct question, are you that prophet, which they meant another one other than the second coming of Elias, other than the coming of Christ? Who could be that prophet except the one from the brethren of the Israelites, i.e. from the Ishmaelite descent, i.e. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? There is more that can be said about the concept of paraclete, but perhaps I stop at that in consideration of the time.
The second question now to Reverend Burns. Does Jesus need the help of his Father, or can they work independently?
I think that, first off, the answer and then an explanation. I believe that Jesus always works in relationship to the Father. I believe that Jesus always works in the relationship to the Father. Jesus speaks, I and the Father are one. Jesus says, I say nothing on my own authority. I listen to the Father and I do what he says. And I know that one of the responses to that is, well, and that shows that Jesus is subordinate to God. That shows that Jesus stands in a relationship to God the Father. That does not mean that reduces the claim of Jesus being God. I think that Jesus, as he lived on this earth, lived in such a way whereby he was dependent upon his Father. I don't know if I understand completely what the incarnation, I know I don't know completely what the incarnation means, but I said earlier that when Jesus was born as a baby, that I don't believe that he lay around in his cradle thinking how neat it is to be God. It seems that maybe in